Welcome to the ladies' room. Today I have a really fun guest, Allan Zola Kronzek, who is a very magical person. He is a magician, an educator, taught in schools for many years, and an author of a panoply of books that are, this one's in 14 languages and sold over a million copies. So he is going to show us some magic tricks today and teach us some very fun stuff. So, Allan, welcome to the show. Thank you for coming.
Hey, thanks for asking me.
Hey. So, you and I met at the Wild Rose, like, I don't know, 40 years ago, 30 years ago.
Yes, yes.
And then we reconnected at the Green Room on the roof of the Sag Harbor Cinema.
Right.
Which is a little gem of a place.
It is.
And you're there every Tuesday night?
Every Tuesday evening.
From 6 to 8:30?
From 6 to 8:30 officially, but if at 8:30 there are people there who want more, I'm there, you know.
And you're just blowing people's minds. I mean, really blowing people's minds.
We're having fun.
We're having fun.
Yeah. It's a great venue. You know, you mentioned the Wild Rose, I no more in existence, but I worked there for many years doing magic and honing a lot of my original magic, and then that disappeared. And I was longing for years for another venue that was perfect for magic. And the Green Room at the cinema turned out to be just perfect.
It really is. And it's, in the summer, it's going to be really great because the deck outside has like a 270-degree view of Sag Harbor and the bay.
Yeah.
The only thing you don't see is Main Street, but there's a deck for that, too.
Okay.
So you're doing, at the Green Room, you're doing up-close magic.
Yes.
So what is up-close magic for people that wouldn't know that?
Well, first of all, magic is a little troublesome term for some people because it has so many meanings. You know, but what do you do? Oh, I'm a magician. I don't pretend I have supernatural powers. You know, what I do close up are illusions, small illusions using, for me, my medium is a deck of cards.
Right.
So I do card magic. Close up meaning it is like this. So at the Green Room, I might be working at the bar for a couple of people there or three or four, but I also have like a larger platform station for performance pieces, for larger pieces. And the other essential thing about close-up magic is that it should be experienced live and in person. For me, magic doesn't work on TV. I know there is some magic on TV, but you don't know what close-up magic is until you see it in person.
Right.
Because in person, it's
in front of you. And everybody's staring at you because they want to catch you, you know, but you're amazing.
Well, some want to catch you and some, hopefully we get over catching pretty quickly because catching is not the point and fooling is not the point. The point is enchanting. The point is trying to give the audience this strange feeling of things are happening that can't be happening. And
how did he do that?
What makes it so cool and interesting is that the audience, at the same time that they're experiencing it, knows that it's a trick. This can't be happening, but it is. It
blows your mind.
And so that cognitive dissonance is very pleasurable.
Yeah. How did you get into magic?
Oh, as a kid. As a kid, I saw a magician on TV, and then I got a birthday present of a magic kit. Misto magic kit, which a lot of kids
Jennifer did. We got one for Jennifer. Yeah.
And I took to it. You know, it just knocked me out. I like the secrets. I like the secrets. I like the apparatus, the gimmicks. I was a shy kid, but I had the opportunity to get up and show people something. And when I learned that you can fool intelligent adults with some very easy things, I think I was hooked.
Did you have mentors? Did you have people that encouraged you or taught?
My parents encouraged me for one thing, And then my dad took me to a magic store. I was brought up in Pittsburgh, and we have Rigo's House of Enchantment.
Wow.
So I'd go there and get some apparatus as a young teen. I didn't really get my first mentors until I was old enough to join the International Brotherhood of Magicians, which had a chapter in Pittsburgh. And
wow.
I was a junior member, and there were several adults, a professor from Pitt University, math guy, an electrician, and there was one other guy, I forget what he did, plumber maybe, who were really into magic and saw me as a young boy trying to get good at it, and they helped me. And then years later, I had one great mentor, Slydini, who was one of the great magicians
Slydini.
Of all time.
Wow.
Absolutely. And
was he in New York?
He was in New York. He had a studio in New York. When I studied with him, which was in the 80s, he had already stopped teaching, didn't want to teach anymore, but I just kept bugging him until he said, okay, I'll have another student. And so I learned a lot from him. And then I was able to join a invitational group of magicians who gather annually and trade secrets.
So you were fascinated by magic. What were the things that fascinated you, that drew you in?
Methods. Uh-huh. You know, I liked the psychology. It's a lot of psychology and why magic works, how people perceive what's going on. And, you know, I remained interested in psychology always. And and performance. You know, I like to do this. It's just very pleasurable to me.
And why card magic?
Because the possibilities...
You can carry a pack of cards.
You can carry a pack of cards, and the number of things you can do with them are virtually infinite.
Yeah.
The literature of card magic is huge. There are thousands of books, and people, magicians, create new card magic every day.
So one of your books, 50 Ways to Cheat at Poker.
52.
52. Well, 52 cards, right.
52 Ways to Cheat at Poker, yeah.
Can you really get away with cheating at poker if you learn things from that book?
Well, there's a subtitle, how to spot it, foil it, and protect yourself against it. So I don't mean it to be a cheating manual.
Okay. It's an educational manual.
Yeah, but, you know, could somebody learn how to do a few things? Sure, if they had the guts to actually try it, because getting caught cheating at poker is not good.
Not good.
You know,
and it's cheating anyway is not good.
For me, I wrote that book when the poker craze was a very hot years ago. But for me, the book is really about the principles of deception, how people are fooled, and what I call the trickster imagination. That is thinking up ways to do things, and in this case, create false realities. A false reality is that this is an honest game and I'm dealing from the top of the deck when, in fact, I'm doing all kinds of things you don't know about.
Wow. Do you want to get into doing some magic now, or should we talk a moment about your new book, Grandpa Magic, which is
we could try something.
No.
We were just talking about the 52 ways to cheat at poker.
Okay.
And a lot of card sleight of hand originated among cheats at the gambling table. They figured out how to.
Probably on pirate ships.
One of the most popular cheating games is known as three-card Monty. Have you heard of that?
Oh, sure.
Okay.
But I thought it was like little things that you moved around. Like
no, that's the shell game you're thinking of.
Okay.
This is three-card Monty that we're going to do with three cards.
Okay, so there's an ace, a two, and a three.
Yes.
Okay.
But the ace is the money card. That's
ace
the one
hearts,
that
okay.
you have to mm-hmm. keep your eye on. Now, when they hustle this in the city, they shuffle the deck very quickly.
Okay.
They try to make you. I don't do that.
Okay.
I do everything kind of slowly. So your job, Judy, is to keep your eye on the ace. Okay?
Okay. It's right on the end, this end. Okay.
That's one.
Yeah, that's
two.
Ace. Okay.
Three.
Okay.
Okay.
So the ace
now, this is
there.
Just for practice, okay?
Okay.
Okay. So, so where is the ace?
Right here.
Funny thing, everybody says that. But no, actually, that's the three. The ace was in the middle. And the two is over here.
I saw you put the ace on the end. Okay.
Well, I may have cheated.
I guess you did.
Usually,
I have to watch closer.
Usually, when they do.
This is close-up magic, and I'm pretty close. So the ace is in the end right there.
You're sure?
Well, yeah, I'm looking at it. But I guess you slide it under.
Here.
Yeah, that's the ace.
Here. Yeah. Here. Now I have to mix them a little bit. Before, you know, I did.
You didn't touch the ace.
So where's the ace?
Near, still.
Ah, Judy, not two times in a row.
So I should have picked the middle.
You should have picked the middle.
Uh-huh. Okay, so now it won't be in the middle.
Well, let's suppose
so
we.
Now the ace is in the middle.
Okay, and let's keep it in the middle, okay?
Okay.
Okay? Are you ready?
Yeah.
Where's the ace, Judy? We're not playing for money.
You didn't move it at all. It's in the middle.
Finally, well, almost. You got one right.
You let me get that right.
I let you get that right.
You let me get that right. So I
good thing we're not playing for money.
Yeah, so I wouldn't feel foolish.
Now, okay. What I'd like you to do is I'm going to switch to two decks of cards.
Okay.
You're going to have your choice of which deck to use. You're going to shuffle one, and I'm going to shuffle the other one. So this is the red deck.
Okay.
And this is the blue deck.
Okay.
Which do you want, the blue back deck or the
I'll
red?
I'll take the blue ones.
You take the blue one, mm-hmm. And you shuffle.
Okay.
I'll take the red, and I'll shuffle. So just mix them up any way you like, as much as you like.
Okay.
Okay?
Yep.
Now, what I'd like you to do is, can you just, I'm going to work with the deck you shuffled.
You
take the deck I shuffled.
Okay.
What I'd like you to do,
more?
No, I want you to do what I do. I want you to take half the cards from the top and put them on the bottom. So that's a cut.
Mm-hmm.
Put the rest on top.
Okay.
Would you cut them again, just like that?
Okay.
Good. Now I'm going to ask you, can you do that cut without looking? Can you just do this without looking?
Yeah.
Okay. Can you now place your hands out of sight?
Both
like
of them?
Behind the counter. Yep.
Both of them?
Yep. And can you cut the deck there?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't want to see the deck. I can't see the cards.
You cut it.
You cut it. Mm. I want you to, you want to cut it again or just leave it the way it is? It's up to you.
No.
Okay. I'm going to look away. I want you to take, without looking at it, take the top card of the deck, turn it face up, and stick it somewhere in the middle.
Okay.
Okay. Don't, did you look at it?
Oh, yeah. Am I supposed to?
I told you not to look at it.
I didn't know.
It down. Cut the deck again.
Okay.
Cut the deck again.
But then how would we know what it was?
Follow my instructions and we'll figure it out. Because you're going to take the top card, turn it face up, don't look at it.
Okay, I won't look at it.
And put it in the middle, face up.
Oh, put it face up in the middle.
In the middle. Have you done that?
I'm getting in the middle. Okay, yep.
Now turn the whole deck face up so your card is now face down.
Face down, okay.
Yeah, and you can put it down here.
Put the whole deck down?
Yeah.
Should I spread it out?
No, don't spread it out.
Okay.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So this is, you have no idea what card you reversed.
Absolutely not.
This is a deck that you shuffled, yes?
Right.
Okay, I'm going to do.
You cut it, right?
I cut it many times, you cut it, you know.
Yeah.
And I'm going to do the same thing that you just did,
okay?
Mm-hmm. I'm going to cut my deck, like so.
Yeah.
I'll cut it again.
Okay.
I'll cut it again.
Okay.
I'll put it out of sight without looking.
Yeah.
I'm going to turn a card face up, put it in, turn my cards face up, like so.
Okay.
So we each have an unknown card face down in the middle.
Right.
I'm going to spread the deck like this. Can you spread yours?
Yeah. Well, probably not as well as you.
That's okay. And there's the one you reversed.
Right.
I'm going to just get rid of all of these cards and all of these cards. Wouldn't it be something?
If it was the same card, it would be. But I can't even imagine how that can happen.
Well, we don't have to look.
Yeah, we have to look.
We have to look?
We have to look.
What do you have?
Ten of hearts. No.
Lucky day.
Oh my God, that's amazing. It just boggles the mind, really.
Me too.
You're so good at what you do, Allan.
I just don't know how that happens.
Yeah. Now, is a trick like that in Grandpa Magic?
No.
No. That's a secret you don't give away. Do magicians ever really give their secrets away? When you were educating, what were you teaching kids?
Science.
Uh-huh. Oh, interesting.
I was teaching, for years, I did school programs. And I did two school programs.
Did they have anything to do with magic?
Yes, I did magic. The science program was about scientific method. But it's really about critical thinking, how we perceive things, how easy it is to be mistaken, how we jump to conclusions, which is all things that operate psychologically in magic.
Uh-huh.
People make assumptions, they jump to conclusions. That way we can fool them, because they fool themselves by assuming things that are not necessarily true. So this was a middle school program where I'd go in and do some stuff and say, hey, that's real. That's not real. I didn't just do that, even though you believe I just did that. And then I would explain what's going on. And then we would end with my doing a trick in which somebody comes up, a kid, and they take a card, and it jumps from the deck magically into my pocket. And the kids now give hypotheses as to how that could be done. What can you dream up to make that, what I just seem to do,
reality?
And there are many, many, many solutions to how you get a card from the deck to your pocket without going anywhere near it.
What solutions do you tell them?
They make up their solutions. And
are
many
of them correct?
Many of them are possible. You know, they may not be what I did, but they, many.
What did you do?
Are often.
Is that a secret you don't give away?
No, I give away that secret.
What is that secret?
I used a trick deck. Half the cards were the same, and half the cards were different. And I would just show the different cards. Somebody would take a card, and I had a duplicate in my pocket. So
What the card they were going to take?
Because the half of them are the same. This, let's say.
They take a card from the deck that half, they're all the same.
Right. I can have the bottom half and show they're all different. Now you take one from the top half, they take it, put it back.
Okay.
So that's one solution to it. But after we go through all of that, then we do the real stuff, which is they take a card, they sign it, so there's only one of a kind, they put it back, and it vanishes from there and ends up in my pocket.
And how do you do that?
Oh, I can't tell you that.
No,
I do it very well. That's how I do it. Yeah.
So you've written a whole bunch of books.
About
the new one is Grandpa Magic.
The latest one is Grandpa Magic, which is about, came about when I was doing magic socially, and even at the Wild Rose, people would say to me, show me something, teach me something I can show the grandkids.
Uh-huh.
And there was like a real, I heard it again and again and again, and my wife said, you know, that's a good idea for a book. And it was. So this, Grandpa Magic is a whole bunch of neat ways to get your grandkids, no matter what their age, off their phones, off their devices, engaged in conversations, doing stuff. And it doesn't require any special apparatus or stuff. It's stuff you, if you're in a restaurant, you can do stuff with the straws and toothpick, napkins. It has puzzles. Let me show you a puzzle in the book, just to see if you can solve this.
I hope I'm not going to look stupid. So you did this book with your daughter?
No, I did the Sorcerer's Companion with my daughter.
Oh, the Sorcerer's Companion is a beautiful book. It's a guide to the magical world of Harry Potter.
Yes, maybe we'll talk about that in a second.
Okay.
Here we have 6 coins.
Okay.
Now, the reason I'm showing you this is the kind of thing you would do for the grandkid if you went out to have a snack and sitting at a restaurant and kid takes out their phone.
Wait,
put your phone away. Let me see if you can figure this out, smarty pants.
Okay.
Okay. I've got 6 coins. I want you to rearrange them so that there are 2 rows of 4 coins each. two rows, four coins each.
Blah. So you would need eight coins for that.
No,
but
just
there must
these.
Be,
just
there
these.
Must be like a, you could do some kind of. It has to be like a kind of cross. I don't know. I can't do it.
So you would let the kid struggle with this for a while,
right,
before you reveal the solution. And there are a lot of brain teasers and puzzles where that once you know the solution, it's aha moment. It's not cheating. I'm really fulfilling two rows of four coins each.
Oh, you put one on top.
Yes. One, two,
Whoa,
three, four. One,
so
two,
simple.
Three, four.
That's so simple. Okay, very cool.
A lot of the things are simple.
Very cool.
So, and there's a cool magic trick in the book. You can take out a dollar and make George Washington stand on his head.
That one, yeah.
Okay, I'll play it to the camera first,
okay.
But the idea is that George Washington is right side up. At no point will I turn George Washington or the bill 180 degrees. Will not do that. I just fold it like this, give it a little tap, and when I unfold it, George Washington will be upside down.
How does that happen? Is that explained in the book?
It is explained in the book.
So how does it happen? Explain it.
I
to
will
me.
Explain it.
Okay.
There are a lot of ways to do it. I fold the bottom up first.
Yeah.
And then you fold, I'm going to fold one half of the bill to the front. Pause for a second. Now when I unfold it, instead of doing this, I'm going to take the back portion, and now the bill is turned over. So that's one way to do
it. Yeah, and that's in Grandpa Magic.
That's in along with a bunch of other cool right. things you can do with the currency.
Cool. You know. And what else is in? And so the illustrations are very cute in the book.
The illustrations are
really
great
fun.
Because
yeah.
when it comes to
shows you how to do the thing.
Yeah, when you're learning magic.
Out.
You really have to
see it.
Yeah. It was a surprise to me when the publisher said, oh, you're going to be a comic book character. You know,
so you became Alcazar in this book.
Exactly.
Because you're talking about Alcazar in this book.
No, Alcazar is in this book.
Oh, okay. A book of magic for young magicians.
Yeah, that was my...
Secrets of Alcazar, okay.
Yeah. Alcazar was a character I invented. The Secrets of Alcazar book is a... for young people, let's say ages 10 and up,
uh-huh.
who are starting in magic.
Mm-hmm.
And Alcazar is the way I wrote the book is from the point of view of the student. I, the writer, am the student, and Alcazar was my teacher. So I am passing along the information that Alcazar, the great wizard, gave me.
And you give away secrets in that book?
Sure, I teach basic magic.
So that's the book if you want to learn the secrets, that's the book to get.
It's a good starter book for anybody, but Grandpa Magic is full of card magic and coin
right.
magic, as well as puzzles and stuff.
And we can get that at any of the bookstores out here?
Most of them. Sure. I know Bookhampton has it
mm-hmm.
in Sag Harbor, Romney Cremorris Gallery,
mm-hmm.
Wharf Shop carries it.
Cool.
And it's on Amazon.
Oh, yeah,
it's
a natural for the Wharf Shop, isn't it?
Yeah, they sell a lot of copies.
Yeah,
amazing.
And this one sold
Amazon
over a million
and
copies.
Target. Mm-hmm. Also Amazon.
Beautiful book. The illustrations are beautiful in this book.
Yeah,
it's
a lot
of
the
Harry Potter stuff.
When I became interested in magic as a kid,
mm-hmm.
I became interested in the idea of magic. So in addition to learning tricks, as I got older, I read anthropology and sociology about magic and magical beliefs and the origins of magical rituals and all of that stuff.
Mystical stuff.
Yeah, I liked all of that. I liked sci-fi.
Yeah.
I liked supposed paranormal. So when the Harry Potter books came out and I read them because in schools, a lot of kids were saying, hey, tell me about Harry Potter. Is magic real? And I read the Harry Potter books. I realized that J.K. Rowling drew upon this rich legacy of lore from Egypt, Persia, Mesopotamia, Greece, and Rome. That's where everything at Hogwarts really comes from. So that book is like a reader's guide to the origins of
magic and mythology and all of that stuff. Very cool. So it's a really interesting book, especially for people that read all the Harry Potter books, right?
Sure. And even if you haven't, I mean, it's an encyclopedia, so it's in alphabetical order. You can read about potions, spells, divination, telling the future, numerology, all of those topics. A cool book. And on Amazon, you can, you know, do the look inside feature, so you can see, you know, get an idea what the book is like.
Oh, right. On Amazon, they let you, they give you a little taste.
Absolutely. Yeah. Same thing with Grandpa Magic. You know, you can have a little taste.
Well, it's been wonderful having you today, and I'm going to definitely learn some tricks because I love things like that.
Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can show me. Come up to the green
room. Oh, come up and see if...
You'll be a guest performer.
Good luck with that. Anyway, Allan, so I hope everyone comes to the green room to meet you and see your tricks.
That'll be cool.
Tuesdays. 6 to 8:30.
So, 6 to 8:30 officially, and 6 to until, you know, I'll stay later if there are people.
Right.
You know, we've been having more and more people.
Well, it is fun. I hear people, the little pockets of people laughing, and it's just great.
It's great. Well,
so
thanks. Thank
you for coming and joining us at the ladies' room.
Sure.
Thank you for watching the show. And remember, people, give yourself lots of room. Room for love, room for fun, room to grow, learn magic, and room to glow. Bring your light into the world. Thank you for joining us. See you next week. We'll